this club has given me a lot of support, a lot of friendship, and a source of joy for during my stay here in Singapore. Unfortunately, we are now in transition, as I mentioned to President Theodore and some other friends. We will soon be moving to Malta, but President Theodore said that it happened. The same thing happened to him, that he continued to come back to Singapore for about a year or two. I will be doing the same, and who knows, maybe I will be able to call this place home again in the near future. Let me say that the book is a little bit difficult to explain. It is metaphysics. So when I spoke with President Theodore about presenting the book, I suggested 3 to 5 minutes, and he said, no, you have plenty of time, 10, 15 minutes. And there's several problems. First of all, 10, 15 minutes of metaphysics, I believe, is a criminal liability. That's the first problem. The second problem is nobody will buy the book because there's nothing left to read. I will and the third problem is that I will create a lot of enemies. So I will try to make some bullet points, and I will try to explain it as I can with a few bullet points. What is it about? First of all, the title is Ecstasy. So every time that I start talking about ecstasy, I get a lot of interesting comments. Either it is about drugs or the oldest trade in the world, but it's neither. It's about metaphysics. Why is it about metaphysics? Because we are experiencing something very interesting today. We are experiencing a convergence of two big mysteries that have puzzled humanity since the beginning of time, which are matter and consciousness. So we all believe that our consciousness is the result of our body, that we were inanimate objects that all of a sudden became animate, and then from being animate we actually developed thought and reason, and we developed a spirit. And for a while this worked. We went through many different cosmologies, from the primitive cosmologies that were animistic and believed that everything contained spirit, the river, the ocean, the clouds, to the Ptolemaic system that saw the Earth at the center of the universe, to the Copernican system that was ratified by Newton. And for a while, we were all very comfortable. But finally, we had a physical universe that was easy to quantify, that was easy to understand. The age of exploration, everybody went around minding their own business, building nations and so on. And finally, a few things came about at the beginning of last century that proved that there's something more. We know that light does not manifest itself as either a particle or a wave. It manifests itself as both. And what triggers the wave to become a particle is the presence of an observer. Particularly a human observer, but it need not be a human observer. We know that space-time is no longer a fixed static. It is relative. We know that objects' mass continue to change depending to their relation with other objects. So a few very intelligent people started asking themselves whether or not there is a physical reality, whether or not what we perceive is anything at all. And there is today a consensus, a absolute consensus, that the physical reality that we experience is at most a wave of probability unless there is an observer. And some very bright people said, well, then what if the physical reality that we perceive is just a projection of our consciousness? Nothing more than that, like the Matrix. That everything we see is something that we are creating nanosecond by nanosecond at the speed of light, and that we are sharing. There is a fundamental problem there, which is that each and every one of us has a very distinct and unique identity, and we all know that we are something separate from every other being. But as I'm speaking to you, and you see me, and I see you, and I have a microphone in my hand, we all see the same microphone, which implies that either this object exists in reality outside of our individual mind, or our mind is connected. Well, our mind, let me put it this way. If our mind were not to be connected, we would have to come up with very bizarre theories, and that is the direction of string theory. that there are parallel universes, that if I slip and fall on a banana peel, I just created a new universe. If I continue to talk and nothing happens, that's another universe. And every instant that passes is universes that build up onto each other, and there are wormholes that we can travel back in time and all kinds of science fiction, which is not likely. In fact, the explanation that everything we perceive is a projection of our consciousness is the only possible explanation to solve the puzzles of quantum physics. The fact that two photons can appear at the same time at distances of light years apart and still know what the other is doing. The fact that the uncertainty principle, the fact that we have no way of knowing the exact mass and location of any given particle until it is observed at a time. Quantum entanglement, it's difficult to go. So what we do, what we understand is that we are experiencing this physical reality as one of those old stop motion movies, but we are in reality projecting it. Given the fact that you accept that matter is a product, an animal construction, a product of our consciousness, what are the implications? Well, in my opinion, the implications are quite beautiful. The implications are, first of all, that nothing is lost. There's no beginning, there's no end. Your loved ones will always be with you, even after they pass away. Another implication is that we are truly a brotherhood of men, a brotherhood of humanity, of men and women. The distinctions of race and nationality are very superficial distinctions. And another very important notion, which explains a lot of the problems we're experiencing today in modern society, the reason why so many youth are incapable of enjoying the freedom of modern society, is that our emotions, our intuitions, our thoughts are just as real, if not more, than our perceptions. And that explains why, once you satisfy the most basic needs of survival, a shelter and some food, emotions are the most valuable things that we have. Everybody knows that emotions are a luxury. Only people with a full stomach can experience love or other type of feelings. But once you have a minimum amount of physical security, emotions are everything to us. So this is what I try to propose in this book. I try to propose that we are not physical beings capable of thought or endowed with spirit. We actually are spiritual beings that are capable, quite miraculously actually, of producing matter. And that this matter that we produce is nothing more than a language for us to communicate and express ourselves and evolve. And that the solution to the freedom that we've acquired with this modern era is in what we produce through our consciousness, which are the works of nature, the maximum expression of beauty that we're capable of. That is why it is called ecstasy. That is why I have Hokusai on the cover, which is the great wave of Kanagawa with the Mount Fuji and the fishermen that are battling the wave. Because it is a relationship between man and society, the relationship between the human beings and the forces of nature. I think that this is enough, otherwise I start going back to